that, but it's, it's just, I think for all musicians, music is a way to kind of make sense of whatever this weird thing is that we call life, right? and so for people who are sort of racial and sexual minorities, in addition to that, it's just another way to kind of process what that means.
Sounds, would you say empathy is a big part of it?
Yeah, totally. Mm-hmm. I like the idea of like sonic empathy.
What does it mean to hear empathy?
I like the way it sounds.
To play.
So, okay, let's do influences next.
Okay.
All right, just kind of jumping around a little bit. You said that you play with these musicians to learn the style, get into their headspace, and learn their experiences. I guess like a more personal way, a little bit.
Yeah.
So, who would you count then as your biggest influences then? How have they impacted your music?
Well, I would say my influences started much earlier than that. Like most trans people who are my age, I'm 36. I didn't actually know about trans as a thing until I was in my late 20s. So my influences started much earlier than that. But I would say that definitely my travels sort of influenced who I was influenced by. So the first singer that I ever heard that I was like, wow, this person, like, what is this thing called music, was Roberto Carlos, who was a working poor Brazilian singer who then learned how to sing in Spanish from Portuguese in order to be more marketable. And now he's huge throughout Latin America. He's a little bit like a Tom Jones, but...
Okay.
But yeah, I won't say anything. He's a little bit in that vein. So
big voice.
I listen to it now and I'm a little bit embarrassed that he was so formative for me. But beautiful songwriter and wrote hundreds and hundreds of songs. He's still performing. I think he's like in his 80s or something.
Wow.
Chabela Vargas is another huge love of mine. She's a Costa Rican singer, also queer, and then nationalized as Mexican, which she just loved. In terms of North American singers, Lucinda Williams is one of my favorite singers of all time. I think her voice is just, I was just talking about her yesterday at the recording studio with Carl Allwire, that her voice is kind of a selective taste. We kind of...
acquired taste.
Acquired taste, thank you. Those are three people I can think of off the top of my head. And lots of female singer-songwriters. As soon as we moved to the States in the 90s, that was kind of when female singer-songwriters really, at least for my generation, kind of really took off. Victoria Mills, Sarah McLachlan, York, right? And so all of that whole era of where female singer-songwriters were really on the radio in all different genres, not just like the Joan Baez, not just the folk singer, they're already everywhere, right? And that was when I first realized, like, oh, I can really do this, right? And then it took me another 15 years to kind of get up the courage to start.
You're still young, so. You got
well, thank
you.
I don't usually out my age, because I think I look a little bit younger than I am.
You do.
But I'm trying to own it. I actually think that getting older is a really thing. I think it's amazing. But I only know that from my own experience. I feel like everything outside of us says, stay young.
No, I'm very glad that I'm not the same person I was when I was 18. I'm a better person now, I hope.
Mm-hmm.
I can hope. I like to try to get technical a little bit.
Okay.
My assumption is that our audience is more of aficionados than casual listeners. So, songwriting technique, right, when you have an idea, how does it develop as you put together a song?
That's a great question. I think I have lots of different techniques, which is maybe another way of saying I don't have to be. I feel like songs come to me in very different kinds of ways. Sometimes I'll have an idea for a lyric and I'll write it down, and then the melody will come just by playing around with those words. More often, I'll be noodling on the accordion, on the ukulele, on the guitar, and just come up with a riff that I really love, and then I'll just start singing over it.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Singing is more natural to me than talking, so it's almost just like thinking over
see.
It, you know.
I like the way you put that.
And
it's
then,
more natural because it's a natural talent.
Yeah.
You know, most people don't have a natural talent. They usually voice coaches and stuff like that. You know, they have to work on it a lot because a lot of people, like myself, you know, as a public speaker and stuff, you know, I don't have a natural gift for it. But people that do, if for some reason it sounds better. You know, the music comes across clearer, better, more understandable,
mm-hmm.
and I think people appreciate that even more. You know, because it's like you said, it's easier than talking and carrying on a conversation. You don't have to think about what you're saying.
Right.
You know, it just flows.
It's more intuitive.
Yeah, it just has a flow to it that
yeah.
people can catch. You
yeah.
know? And you can actually tell. You can actually, if you listen to music, you can actually tell who's been taught, you know, and who actually knows, you know. It's amazing. I mean, some people are meant to be painters, some people are meant to be, you know, steel workers, and it's a natural talent, you know. But when it comes to artists, a natural artist is something that's very unique. Art form in itself, practicing any art, is unique, but a natural talent at it is just off the chain to me. So I give you your kudos for that.
Thanks. Yeah, and I would say that, like, you know, kids tend to sing before they can speak.
Yeah.
And, like, singing is, like, making noise without intellectual energy.
Yeah.
so
that's usually the first thing they hear. Is
right.
lullabies. Is,
yeah.
Yeah, it's lullabies. Or even before they're born. Somebody's talking to them while they're in their stomach, you know,
mm-hmm.
and keeping the baby calm and kicking, whatever, you know.
Right.
But,
singing in the shower while your baby's listening.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Somebody's always listening. But can I ask you a question? How is your singing career here locally? I mean, do you get a lot of bookings and stuff like that here locally, or?
I'm pretty new to the area, so I'm still, but I play out a lot. I play a lot of the open mics, at the cafeteria, DuPaul's, Carl Aller's, open mic, the Sandwich Shelter, Tuesday nights, various other ones.
Right.
Yeah, and I've been really focused recently on this record that I'm making. So more focused on the recording aspect than the performing for now. But before I moved here in Chicago, I had a band called Eli and the No Good that you can find on Facebook. And we performed once a month for years.
Do you have any albums or any recordings like on SoundCloud, stuff like that?
I do, yeah.
I'd love to get that information out to our listeners where they can actually look it up. And if you can write it down, I'll make sure it hits the Facebook and stuff so they'll get it.
Sure,
they'll get it on
great.
YouTube because we're recording with both cameras. And they'll have it on YouTube.
Okay.
And also, I'm going to set it on the amp. And I can put it on Facebook. They'll see it on Facebook because we have a large following on Facebook also. The whole idea is most artists usually have to sell so many, you know, records or albums before they get radio play. You know, and this is one of the things that we're trying to do is bringing unknown artists locally up to that level where they get those sales where they can actually be played on other radio stations. So this is what we're trying to do. We do the same thing. We're fundraisers, small businesses, entertainment, arts is what we concentrate on, you know, and if you have a concert or an event that you'd like recorded and put on YouTube, we can do that too. This is how we try to highlight sales of your albums or your career can actually be more often and more readily. So we actually try to back you up and being volunteers doing what we love to do. You know, it's not, it's very cost efficient. You know, and so we try to help the starving artist have a meal. You know, but yeah, I'm really interested in hearing your music. I really am. But if you want to give us the SoundCloud or your website where our audience can actually look it up and listen to your music, you can go ahead and do that right now.
So I have a website. I guess I'll start with that. It's just www.elias, E-L-I-A-S, Krell, K-R-E-L-L.com. And all the links are off of that, but I have a SoundCloud that you can also look up by my name, Elias Krell, and CD Baby has the three albums that I've put out. They're all self-produced. The one I just recorded the last couple days was in Paul Antonell's beautiful clubhouse up in Rhinebeck. Between Red Hook and
Rhinebeck,
I'm not sure.
I guess that leads us right into this current project, the album you're recording. What can you tell us about it?
Oh my gosh, I'm so excited about this album. I just spent like the two most amazing days at Clubhouse with Carl and Manuel Quintana. He's an incredible percussionist. Carl and Manuel, I think, are just two of the most talented musicians I've ever seen or heard. And Paul is a production genius. And so to have the three of them working on my songs has just been incredible. It's a six-song EP. Two of the songs are in Spanish. One of those is a cover of a song that actually Chavela Vargas made famous called Simples Cosas. The rest of them are mine. Five originals, and they're all really different, but they all really come together as an album, which was kind of my goal. I'm kind of a quirky person by nature, so I wanted them to each really have their own personality.
And I can tell you right now, I'm married to a Puerto Rican family, so you can have a lot of hits already. I mean, my wife, my grandkids, my son, they're four brothers.
Perfect.
And wives. They're going to have some hits. They're going to love this.
How did you, and Paul? Was that the producer?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Paul and Tim.
How did you two come together?
Carl Aller recommended him.
Okay.
Yeah, I was asking him, you know, who could I work with in the area? What are the recording situations like? I've never been in a financial position to be able to afford a professional studio, and now that I could, that I asked for that recommendation, right? I always think it's important to talk about, like, capital when we're talking about being musicians, because that's like one of the biggest struggles, right? Is like, how can we afford to do what we want to do? But yeah, so he recommended actually both Manuel and Paul. I'm super grateful to him for that. And he was also sort of the music director during the recording process, so he would kind of help both Paul and I figure out, you know, what it's doing.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So, I've heard Carl play many times. I'm a big admirer of his guitar playing. And I think I kind of know in general how he plays. But how would you describe the total sound of the project? Acoustic, right?
It is acoustic. Yeah, it's acoustic with, like, electric, like, here and there. So I wrote a song called Horizonte, which is in Spanish, but it's basically like a rock song that is in Spanish but also has congas. So we were just talking, so I'm mixed, so my dad's white and my mom's Latin American, and so we were talking about genre yesterday, and it's interesting because I don't hear like a Spanish music genre, and I'm doing like the quotes. Because there's bachata, there's merengue, there's salsa, there's norteño, like there's all of these different sounds and all of these different rhythms, right? And so we were talking in the studio about like how is the song Spanish or isn't it, you know, and Carl was saying like, oh, I hear a sort of clap, like maybe a classical Spanish solo here, and I was like, I hear electric guitar there. So, like, we had this really interesting conversation about like, well, why do we hear classical or why do I hear electric, right? And he ended up playing it on electric, and it I mean, it's my album, so I get to decide. But I think it worked, right? And I think they thought it worked too.
You can change a lot of things, but you can't change the song.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's what I'm really most excited about musically is like not just transgender, but transgenre. Like, what is it? Right? And there's lots of folks doing really interesting, you know, not just blending of genres, but actually like trying to make new sounds.
Yeah. These are the hidden talents that I talk about. You know, there's so many hidden talented people out there that's just not getting the spotlight that they deserve.
Yeah.
You know, and I think they deserve to be heard.
Like,
you know, and that's they need to be put on a platform to where they can be heard and have a chance. You know, a lot of people's dreams, you know, do come true, but a lot of people's don't. You know, they need to know. But all together, they all need to be heard. So they need to know. I've changed my directions in my 54 years. I've changed the direction of my life at least 6 or 7 times. You know, so I was never musically inclined, so that's not one of them, but I do love music, you know, and I love the people who can perform music and do it well. So these are talents that I like to enhance. I'm just saying, everybody deserves a chance at their dream. That's what they're able to do. They should actually have that shot. So that's why I've been here 23 years, doing what I do. So, but I'm really interested in hearing your music. I really am. And I know that a lot of our listeners are going to be listening this morning. And I'm going to hear it when I get home. Who is that? And I'm going to say, it's right here. Go turn the computer on. Put your headphones on.
And I'll send you guys info for the new record when it's out. Should be out.
It's salsa and merengue up here all the time. All the time. And, you know, it's so...
One of my favorite radio stations ever is up here. Juan, Ando lo que te gusta. Yeah, that's such a good station.
We have a Spanish station right across the street. Right
okay. Here. There's a lot happening in Hudson Valley.
Yes, there is.
So, right before we get on to the music, which I'm also looking forward to, you've got such a unique singing voice. Or if you could tell us just a little bit about how you developed your voice. You said you started out with opera.
I did, yeah.
But now you're singing in a very different style.
Yes. I would say, like, I used to sing in this style, and then... Well, I've kind of always had like a folk side. The classical training, I loved how powerful I felt when I sang, you know, because they teach you to be able to sing in like a 500 to 1,000 person hall without implication, over an entire orchestra. Which is actually not quite as hard as it sounds because the overtones of the voice are different than so it carries. But it was a really, I love using my body to like make, you know, to for my work. I think like people who are construction workers or massage therapists or anybody who is really sort of in their body day to day and what they're doing.
Very expressionatory on stage.
Yeah, I love that about opera, the sort of the breath. And the breath is really what I carry over into my singing now still. Just how we're sort of similar to accordions in some ways, is that we think of singing as sound, but it's really like 90% breath, right? And so, if the breath isn't flowing as much as it could, that's right there, that's 90% of your sound that's either coming out or not. And then at some point in my classical training and some, you know, people who have, I had such an intense urge to write my own music that I think I never would have been satisfied just singing opera. And also as a soprano, I played the same role over and over and over again. I felt like, the ingenue, the good guy. Yeah, and, you know, at least I wasn't like the scary bad woman, but there's really kind of a dichotomy in opera where you're either one or the other. And it just kind of got tiring. I just got a little bored with that.
Everybody gets burned out.
Right, and then there's all the dynamics in the cast that are way more complicated than that, right? And so none of those dynamics actually come out in the story. And so what's happening behind the scenes is actually much more interesting. So I don't know if this might be weird for your, I'm not sure for you, I was born female, and this relates to sort of my voice stuff, but I go on and off of testosterone because I identify as male and female, and sometimes I like to present as male and sometimes I like to present as female. So the biggest change that happened to my voice on a technical level is that it dropped really low because of the testosterone, and so my voice is probably a sixth lower, not quite an octave, but like a sixth lower than it was. And that was huge to transition to. So before, when I was an opera singer, I had one voice from the bottom to top, because that's how they train you to have one sound.
Mm-hmm.
And then what happened after it dropped is that now I have a falsetto, like most men, right? So, right? Like really different sounds. Whereas before it would have sounded like one voice. So I had to adjust not just to the range drop, but to having vocal breaks,
mm-hmm.
which I hadn't had in like 10 years, and then figuring out where those breaks were and how to navigate them. So it was almost like, you know, having a new bicycle and having to relearn how to ride a bike.
Well, that's very interesting.
Okay.
I'm glad you shared that with us. That's very,
thanks.
Very
and now, so it's been 4 years that I've been singing with this voice. So I now feel like, finally, I really feel like I'm kind of settled into it and not learning how to play it again, so to speak. Or learning how to play it. I sort of feel like I'm more in it. But I still have moments where I'm like, is my voice down here? Or is it up here? Right? It's like,
it's variable.
It's both, right? It's like, that's who I am. But it's I remember, Brian, like one of the first times that you heard me sing, like you mentioned it, because you're, you know, a very astute listener, and you said
so interesting,
like,
it's
really low, and I was like, yeah, it's like, it's not really something that I feel like if people want to hear right off the bat when they've heard me, so I was just like, yeah, it is low.
Well, it's very,
you know,
it's a very warm voice, that's what struck me about it.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, the interesting thing is that the timbre, the timbre doesn't change that much, like a lot of transgender men, right? Maybe you know this already, but just in case your listeners don't know, you say the way that people identify, not that they were born. So transgender men are people who identify as male and were probably born female. So a lot of trans men on testosterone, it's really interesting. It's part of what I write about in my research, is that their voices change register-wise, but you still hear so much carryover in terms of the timbre, in terms of the articulation, the kind of the rhythm of their speech.
Yeah.
So it sounds like a completely different voice. My voice, for whatever reason, didn't change as drastically as a lot of other people. But it kind of went back up when I went off the testosterone. It's not supposed to do that. There's not very much medical information on it, but the little that there is says that it's permanent, it's not supposed to go up. So I don't know if I just have more plasticity from singing opera for 15 years or what.
That makes you a unique performer, right?
Yeah.
What is the clinical side? You're a unique performer, multi-talented performer.
Oh, thank you very much.
Very interesting.
No pressure.
You won't find it here. You won't find it here.
No, I know.
You find plenty of coffee early in the morning, isn't it?
So I'll just jump in real quick before we get to some music I'm looking forward to hearing. This is WHVW 950AM. You're listening to Happenings Around the Hudson Valley. My name is James Burke. My co-host is Stanley Moss. And normally we'd be just about getting ready to sign off at 8 o'clock, but as you know, our friend and colleague Joel Tyner is not going to be making it in today. He's working with the blood drive in Rhinebeck. So we're going to be running over a little bit today, which is great because we have Elias Carell in with us, and we're about to hear some lovely music. So
I'll be recording this for Facebook. The YouTube recordings and the Facebook recordings.
All right.
Not to put you on the spot.
question would be, is this a song from your upcoming EP?
It is.
Okay, great. What's it called?
Yes, I'm trying to decide what it's called.
I know that feeling. I know that feeling.
Yeah, it was called Only You, and then I thought, oh god, it's that terrible movie from the 90s. And then, and, you know, and another good song. And then I think it might also be called Your Flower. So, and I'm playing it on a banjo ukulele in case it comes.
Okay.
Being a little bit catty with some of the things that he like gifted me were gone in the song. And so it's just sort of about like talking about what I'm seeing as a way of processing heartbreak.
Yeah. I've been through that, moving and breaking up at the same time. Yeah.
Yeah, I guess it is related to moving. Yeah, I didn't make that connection until right, but of course it's about things not being where you think they are, right? Both in terms of where people's emotions are and where your emotions are, and also like your physical belongings.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a good question.
And the reason that I moved is I'm staying with a friend in Rhinebeck for a couple of weeks, and then I'm moving to Mexico for 2 months.
You just came back from a trip abroad, didn't you?
I just got back from Argentina.
Yeah.
That I was in Buenos Aires studying a couple of bands. This wonderful, incredible artist who's trans and indigenous. Her name is Susie Shock. You can also find her on Facebook. And another band called Senti Meloninga. They're Argentinian bands who write about trans rights and women's rights and indigenous rights. And this trip to Mexico that I have coming up is a bit more exploratory and more personal. I lived in Mexico for a year when I was a kid.
Can I ask you what part of Mexico?
Yeah, I'm going to be in Mexico City.
Okay. The reason I say that is because my daughter, which is now 14, she was born in Sierra Vista, Arizona, which is just like 20 miles away from the border.
Okay,
it's
yeah.
Tombstone, Arizona.
Yeah, I lived in Guernavaca when I was little, which is just a couple of hours, not even from Mexico City. But I have some friends of friends there that I'm excited to collaborate with and get to know in this queer performance scene. So I'll be busking on the streets of Mexico City in case anyone's planning to take a trip. Come see me.
Yeah,
and
I used to go to the Gallus in Mexico City, you know.
Yeah. I'm bringing my little chihuahua, and I keep expecting that I'll have like a homecoming experience.
You're home!
I may or may not have bought him a little sombrero to wear while I'm busking.
Oh, you gotta send me some pictures on Facebook now.
I know. I'm really excited.
I tried a picture of some brother on the show. Standing next to the sidewalk on the Mexico City.
I was like, how could I find a sombrero? Apparently there's like a huge market for chihuahuas.
Yes, there is. They make them for cats and they go for dogs. I was like, oh my god.
My coworkers in my day job have been talking about their dogs all week. I have to make sure they know that you can buy a sombrero for your dog.
Yes. And wigs too, wigs. I think. I think they make wigs. I'm not going to go that far, but
that's,
my dog already has a lot of hair.
I keep a sombrero hung up on my wall, and I keep little Corona sombreros on the beer bottles that I have on the top of my hutch. That's about it. That's for Cinco de Mayo, so I'll just bring them out. We may fit.
We have another song or two here? Love
yeah,
to if you want
to play. Have time.
Yes,
okay,
we do.
Just let me chime in too. While I'm tuning in, I just want to say thank you, James. I don't think I caught your name.
My name's Stan.
Thank you, Stan. Since
our pleasure. Been looking forward to this.
But this is a little bit of a critique of masculinity, actually, this song. I think for me, I don't want to get too soapboxy, so just stay really brief, but feminism is just the idea that everyone is equally complex as a human being, right, and is worthy of being seen as such. Yeah, it's hard to talk about without sounding like you're vilifying men, but I think one of the things that makes it one of the effects of patriarchy is that, and it really holds men back as much as it holds women back, is that there's a sort of lack of emotional development, I think, that men are expected to, or even able to have oftentimes, because of the ways that they are made the center of attention, and that women have to kind of do more of the emotional labor. And I've seen this happen in my family, right? And my brother was very favored by not just my mom, but my entire Latin American family, right? So culture also plays into it. And people may relate to this or not, but I think what I really want in terms of like healing for the world is for us to be able to talk about these things, you know, and just sort of think about like
have an open dialogue.
Yeah, like even the kind of thing where I can tell you how many times that I've been in a group of men looking the way I do now, right? Especially being trans and having experienced both sides of this, I can really tell the difference. That where they'll just talk to each other and it's like I'm not even there. It happens all the time, women experience this all the time, and it's almost like we're, you know, we're furniture or we're an accessory to a human being rather than an actual person, right? And I think it's subtle, but it's, imagine experiencing that every day of your life, right? It has an effect. And so this song is about kind of, and I'm attracted to all sorts of people, but I date men too, and it's about sort of being like loving someone who's like that, right? Or being attracted to people who may or may not do that to you, which is like a very confusing thing. So that's what the song is. Very long preamble, and it's called High School Boy. High school boy. High school boy.
Was that the bit you said you were debating with Carl about a acoustic or electric?
No, actually that's a different song. Yeah. It's a song in Spanish that I brought my guitar if y'all want to hang out.
I'd love to.
Yeah.
I'd love to.
We'll do a little change.
Say, but going back to the inspiration for that song, I'd heard about that kind of thing before, about toxic masculinity, if you want to call it that. I remember there was some article published after the Orlando shootings about toxic masculinity and how it holds men back too.
Yeah.
Tuning up on the refreshing on my Java.
And I think it can be more subtle than that too. Like it doesn't have to be. I would say like the toxic patriarchy, not toxic masculinity.
Okay.
Right. I think masculinity is a really beautiful thing, and that just like femininity is, but I think that the trick is figuring out how to do it in a way that doesn't play into the hierarchy, right? Like that's
right,
the...
Right, that's the key.
Yeah, and I think it can totally be done. It's...
The callback, just while you're still tuning up, I'll check.
Okay.
Hello. Mr. Tyne? He's not going to be in today. He's helping out with the blood drive. We're with another guest right now. If you don't mind holding, we can talk to you in a little bit. Robert Pemberton has called in. He'll be talking to us in a little bit. Are you already?
I am.
All right, what is this song?
So this song is called Horizonte, which means horizon in Spanish. And it's nice to end with a song on a little lighter note. This is just about falling in love and that the feeling that you have when you really have a connection with someone, right? It almost feels like it's sweeping you off your feet. And I was expecting a visit from this person who I've been... who had been a friend, not like we'd met online, but we had been kind of like chatting, you know, over Skype and stuff, and I was really excited to see them. And so it was sort of that feeling of this horizon. So it's all about, this song is all about air. So this is the song that Carl did an electric solo on. And there's congas on this too, so I'll just start.
Excuse me.
Una nueva aventura que me viene atravesando. Una imagen del agua que cambiará con el viento. Un empleo, un reflejo, un atardecer. Una sombra, sonrisa, malentendido. Un espejo. Así me quedo en el cielo, pa' que cuando me ves también te veo. Una caja de recuerdos que se olvida, el tiempo y el molde se hundan. La tela y el carbón. Cuando me ves también te veo.
Thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you, Stan.
It was a
James.
Pleasure
it's
to
my
talk
pleasure.
To you.
It's
been
listeners.
Our pleasure.
Once again, online, if people wanted to find you.
Yeah.
You have the website.
ElliasKrell.com, ElliasKrell.com.
So it has links to SoundCloud.
Yes, YouTube, iTunes, all of that good stuff.
Excellent. Looking forward to getting my hands on the CP when it comes out in a couple months.
Thank you, James. Appreciate
yes.
it.
Thank you so much
all
for
right.
coming out.
Thanks to both of you.
Thank you.
No problem. Yeah. Anytime we can help, if you'd like to come back, please do.
I'd love to.
The music of Elias Krell, and it was a pleasure to have Elias in the studio with us. Holding right now is Robert Pemberton, who I'm sure is going to want to talk to us a little bit about the Stop the Violence March coming up at the end of the month. But with the stuff I have going on later this afternoon, I think I should probably hit the road to go get ready for it.
Yeah, it's
would you
concert
like to,
this afternoon.
Would you like to take my place?
Well, I'll talk to him for a few minutes on the phone, but I do have my two kids at the house, and my son is leaving back to Texas tomorrow, and I want to spend a little time with him. But we are running over, but when he calls back, I do want to...
He's on hold.
Okay,
right now,
so I'll take this call, because it's very important. But yeah, let me talk to him for a few minutes before we sign off.
Hello, Mr. Pemberton, are you there with us?
Good morning, sir. Stan Moss here.
Hello.
How are you doing today?
Morning, how are you, sir?
I'm having a long day and a long night. No sleep, but we're here. Got concerts to... Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, I'm here. Oh, anytime. Any time at all.
One heck of an event, but, you know, it's hard to look forward with a week that we had in America of downright. You know, on both sides of the line here. And we stand with Minnesota and Louisiana and Texas.
Yes.
Just know that Orlando and so many others. The Stop the Violence movement has gotten huge since last Saturday. The new things that are happening, we're going to revamp the march a little bit to a new Orleans style march. We had the Musicians Union take care of that for us.
Right.
They have fully committed to this event, along with 1195 and their team. Nina has fully committed to this event, which is huge. The local 200 union has committed. They will be in full force in the local 420, I believe, which is the Musicians Union there.
Right.
So we have gained a lot of steam, as we like to say, on the Stop the Violence train.
That's it.
And we are now projecting numbers at the Kipsey Riverfront of well over 3,000 to 4,000 people. And that's great to hear that and to be able to share that with the listeners this morning.
Yes, and that's a blessing in itself. Amen. That is a blessing in itself. The bigger, the better, the more, the merrier. This is something that needs to be heard, be seen, followed up by other towns, and, you know, and other communities. And I'm so glad it's going to be an annual event here. It's just awesome. I know you're going to be having T-shirts and stuff on, like that on sale. I want to get one of those myself.
The T-shirts would be available the 15th, which I think is next Thursday. The gentleman has been very, very busy, but he promised to produce the shirt in a mass production shirts with a part of the proceeds going back to our youth, the PTA board, and the Cabal Alex Foundation. So it's a win-win to get the purchase of the shirt and wear that and wear it with pride and then know that, you know, part of the proceeds go right back to the community. But we can't emphasize enough that we agreed on the conference call yesterday that in the most positive way, the kids do, and actually we, the county has never seen an event like this. And the weird part is the people behind us, we know what's at stake here. We know what kind of event is coming to the Kinsey, and the people don't know, but get ready. This is going to be hands down the most historic positive event the county's ever seen. We stand by that, and we are going to produce from start to finish and for many, many years to come. One heck of a event. We have a meeting Tuesday with the mayor to go over our whole agenda, our motto, our message, but to also to serve the city administration. Notice on Saturday, July 23rd, they must be all in with no reservation. We're thinking strongly about a community review board brought by members of the community. We want to start talks of community policing because we know that community policing works. And if you pay attention to history, years and years ago, we had community policing, and that was called the elders of the neighborhood. We didn't have all this shooting and killing because it was accountability back then, and somewhere down the lines, we lost accountability from the home all the way to the politicians. And now, like never before, it's accountability and transparency time across the board with no reservations. You're either all in for change or you're all out. You know, the days of complaining, of the yesterdays of this, we tried this and this don't work, and they turned us down, we will not take a back seat to any idea or suggestion that has to do with changing the violence in the Kipsy across the board, and that's from the homes, to the streets, to the schools, and whatnot. You know, it's time. We always talk about the YMCA, the Boys and Girls Club, and whatnot, and I don't know if them organizations are coming back, but there's no reason why we can't fast-track the stud program. There's no reason why we can't get a functional YMCA with affordable childcare, with affordable rates for our community members to be able to become members. This is one heck of an event. We have more dignitaries that jumped on board this week, just to name a few. Father Jesus Jackson is attended this movement. We reached out to Sean Patrick Mahoney.
Yes, indeed. They're both friends of mine, so I am really glad Sean Patrick Mahoney is coming. I sent him an invite, but I can't take credit for him accepting it. I'm sure he got several from several people. Barbara Jeter Jackson, I also know her, and same as Joel Tyner. These are some of the individuals that I sent invitations out to. But I can't take credit for them accepting mine because I'm sure they got a lot of them from a lot of people. Now, myself, I'm going to try to be walking in front of the parade in order to record it for YouTube and try to get a broad spectrum of how many people are going to be in the march. Just to have that, like I said, the more people, the better off it is. I want to make it a worldwide event because I think everybody needs to be standing up for the same cause. This has to change. We can't survive like this. I remember that.
And when I mentioned your name yesterday in the conference call with what I like to call the higher ups in the union, they have joined in on production of this event. So if you happen to miss something, they're back and they won't miss it. So there will be a full production team there also, covering this event, editing it, and getting it back out to the public on a DVD or a CD version. We have, of course, you're going to be there doing what you do. We have Super Latina Radio that will be in attendance and airing this event down at the riverfront. This thing is a lot bigger than last week, and we know we have 2 weeks to go, and it's going to get bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yes.
This is make or break July 23rd, and I think that for the most part, we clearly understand what's at stake here. It's not about money, not about the new jail, not about politics in the whole. It's about the people. We understand that we must deliver. Excuse me. Not only the masses to show unity, but we must deliver one hell of a message. And then we have to, as I say, put feet on the street right after, and continue to pull this community together. We are prepared in every fashion. If the dignitaries that are in attendance say that they're all in and they back out, we will hold them accountable by any means necessary. If it's staging sit-ins, if it's writing the governor, if it's writing the media, we claim to have the upwards of 7 media outlets there covering this event, from the march to the Unity in the Community event. And there will be a host. It's a long list of political people that will be there. But also there's a long list of victims, family members that are there. We have a nurse that's associated with knives that will be speaking on the session with acts of violence and how that affects nurses and doctors within the emergency room. Just to share that side of the story, which we don't never hear about the trauma that is caused at people that get paid to take care of trauma patients.
Yes.
This event, we understand the magnitude, and we will, the only promise that we can make to the community is that we will take full advantage, but they must understand that they have to be all in also for this thing to work. And that's our motto. We backed that up about 2 weeks ago, and we're all in with no reservation.
As being, don't even interrupt you, but as being a survivor of violent crime, two of them in fact, here in the city of Poughkeepsie, my wife, my family, she's just had surgery on her feet, but she's still going to be bringing her walker out. She's going to meet us at Market Street and walk the rest of the way down with my family.
Wife, we have a bunch of strong young men that would carry her to the riverfront. So she will make it there. She will make it there by any means necessary. Stella, if that's my word, if you have to carry her, we will carry her to the riverfront.
Yeah. She knows what I've been through, and she suffered it with me. I mean, I've been shot in the city of Poughkeepsie, and I've had my throat cut in the city of Poughkeepsie, you know, and she knows about it. The family's been through it with me, you know, so I know what violent crime is. If it wasn't for John Flowers, I'd probably still be you know, out on the street without a family because of the way the depression I sunk into. But the thing is, I'm going to be covering it from when we leave the park right up to Main Street and right on down Main Street. I wished I had a car or something I could record it from without doing the walking, but I don't. Everything I do is pretty much on foot. But
to get you on that float, the smoke would leave the marshes. I believe that we can get you up on that float, get you on the back of that float, and which is, my understanding, is a simple hotbed with a band on it. I've never seen a Louisiana style protest or march before, but I heard it's different, it's trendy, and it's powerful. I believe we can get you out there, and because it is a long march, we do tell the public that this is a long march.
Yes, it is.
And we will have water and snacks passed along the route, just so people can stay hydrated and eat a quick snack, because it is a long march. You're talking about the middle of the summer, hot days.
Yeah, I noticed you got a time down for basically an hour and a half between 2 and 3:30 just to get down to Juarez Park and start your commencement speeches and the rest of the rally down there. But I do have a lot of people that's going to be at Juarez Park that can't make the march. But I also have some talented young people that would like to play, music as far as the music goes. But it was my fault that I missed the meeting at 33 Clover Street last month, because I was having some back problems, really bad back problems, and I had an in-home nurse taking care of me at the time. And I'm still having problems from what had taken place with me. But that's the reason I have a hard time getting around. But I just had shots, cortisone shots in my knees, and I'm ready to go. But other than that, I'm anxiously waiting on the 23rd. This is going to be the biggest rally that the city of Poughkeepsie has ever seen, that I'm aware of. I was with Ms. Rosanna Squire last year, and just before July 4th of last year, there was several shootings, and I went to the city council meeting after that, and they had the investigator from the state there, I believe it was the FBI, that was looking into the shootings just before the rally, and he couldn't comment on anything because it was an ongoing investigation. And that was the very last I heard of it. And all the shootings that took place, I think there was like 5. And that was over a couple of days before the 4th and on the 4th of July of last year. And that was the last that I heard of it. And quite frankly, I don't think that any of what's going on recently, just before this rally, should be swept under the rug. The transparency needs to be there. The people need to be there in support. And I'm constantly asking for the support of people. If you're doing nothing and sitting at home, then you're doing just that, nothing.
You also know that, and I'm deeply concerned of, when Mr. Trump came to town, I think that was a $30,000 bill. And he can find $30,000 and get a whole bunch of police security and whatnot to fund one of the most racist, controversial people to run for presidency. It's
right.
My livelihood.
In history.
and not that I totally support the other candidate either, but we can find $30,000, but we don't have, we don't even have one center completely funded by the county or the city of Poughkeepsie for these young people to go to. Is utterly disgusting and shows the lack of accountability and the lack of transparency for our local government. And that, the promise to the people is that will stop. We will shed light on the fact that we do have a new mayor.
Yes.
Yes, but at the same token, it is incumbent on him to begin breaking down the barrier of the broken promises of yesterday when I speak to people like Melissa Whitaker and
yes.
Ray Sonja Squire and Amelia Miller, and they, you can hear it in their voice, the passion, but you also get a sense of they're fed up, their faith is lost within the administration of, is anything ever going to change? I haven't been in the local papers recently, and I don't know even if the mayor has spoke out about the Rasser shooting this summer.
I haven't heard anything. I really haven't. What I've heard is the police cars, the ambulances, and my neighbors, because I live right downtown.
We look at the skate park, and we can have our local politicians, you know, air on Facebook on how people are buying houses and planting trees on Gifford Street. But then I was personally at that skate park last week and couldn't believe that less than 200 feet away, you know, you have a beautiful restaurant with all the bells and whistles, and a place that is designated for the children is utterly and thoroughly look like a hellhole.
Right.
But then 20 feet next to that is a pavilion owned by the Children's Museum, and that is wonderful. So it's clear to me as being someone that visited that riverfront what is happening. We look at you know, a bridge that 400,000 people walk across a year, and right underneath that is where our children are supposed to play in a skate park with ramps that has holes on it, overgrown grass. I don't even know if it was a check-in booth or what. That's all run down and raggedy. So we must shift the focus here to stop the beautification of what's already beautiful and what's already pristine, and get our hands dirty, and get it dirty for the better of our community as a whole. We know that they're first riding in McKinsey, but it's odd to me that the inner city, as I like to say, the heart of the city, none of the businesses were even taking that along first Friday. So what is our message? To come out to Market Street, to come out to downtown McKinsey on a Friday night, or is it to come out of McKinsey in the whole and see our beautiful city? Because it is a beautiful city, filled with beautiful people. As I like to say, we can continue as a community to keep sucking that pacifier that our administration, past and present, keeps putting on our mouth, where we can give it back and demand real change in the city of Poughkeepsie. There's no daggone reason why there's not an up and running community center focused on our children, focused on that most of our children live two times under the poverty limit.
Yes.
Our politicians must do a better job, but we as the people must also do a better job.
Exactly.
We have to do a better job, or this thing, as far as stopping incest with acts of violence, and that's gun violence, domestic violence, it's bullying in schools, you know, it's the back door, as I like to call the back door of political deals that happen in the public doesn't know. That's got to stop. And it starts with accountability. I can't preach it, I can't say it any louder. It's accountability and transparency time. But our local officials, we do hold them to a higher standard, and we expect that Tuesday, when we have a meeting with the city administrator, the mayor, the police chief, and other members of the mayor's team, that we can start the process of change. And we will inform the community of the outcome of this meeting, because I will tell you this, that a week ago they tried to talk this march, and to be quite honest, and I never played a race card, and never will, but they tried to halt this march to the poor white, the rundown black, and the no-good Latino community, and they did not want us to go down the heart of Main Street. I took that to the meeting, and we agreed that we will go straight to the riverfront because we have that right. I don't believe any marcher or Martin Luther King or any of them in the 60s ever asked permission to march from place to place. We just marched.
Right.
They have changed their position slightly.
That is sad to hear. That is truly sad to hear.
We also had a member of the mayor's team, claim that selling t-shirts, and this is the mindset of Poughkeepsie right now, of the administration. The mayor, secretary, with a straight face, looked at me and said, it's okay for the young man to sell t-shirts in Mansion Square Park, but when you get to the riverfront, it's called vending. And I simply responded to her that this is a stop the violence movement, and how dare you say if a man is able, a businessman at that, is able to attain a business in the city of Poughkeepsie and be able to sell a t-shirt for the cause, how do you tell him that he needs a permit because he's making a couple dollars, but until he's spending his money right straight back to the community? What is you gave to the community? So this is what kind of administration we had in the past. We do have a rookie mayor, and that's understandable. But the mindset is still of the old administration. We're going to suck every dime out of people, and if we don't agree with your bet, we will hold our application pamphlet in front of you and show you that every vendor needs a license, and every vendor has to apply for a special vendor's license. And we had feet on the street last week over the July 4th weekend and realized that people were at the riverfront selling the 4th of July stuff, and they didn't have a permit. We are this Stop the Violence movement. People do not want this to happen. And if they do, they want it to happen in a particular way. To tell 600 and almost 40 people, 8,400 people that know about it, that as long as you walk through the hood in the ghetto, we don't have a problem with it. But when you come down the heart of the city, we got a problem with it. But at the same turn, we won't turn the city around from the heart of the city outward, because that's not good for business. That practice will stop. But we have begun stopping that practice as of last week, and we will definitely do it Tuesday. Once again, we have aligned ourselves with powerful people, but there's no more powerful people than the people itself. And when they come out in droves on July 23rd, and we jam-pack that park, which is a city-owned park, it's not a state-owned park, it's a city-owned park. When we pack that out, the message is loud and clear. Across the board, it's accountability and transparency time.
Right. That's like having a license to open a bar in a city park. That's something I don't understand. And you have one, what used to be an ice cream stand is now a bar and a restaurant. And that's right there in Juarez Park. I don't understand how it works for some and not for others. But as far as the city of Poughkeepsie knows, they know that this is happens around the Hudson as a total volunteer organization, And we titled it Happenings Around the Hudson in order to benefit the businesses, the talent, and in the city of Poughkeepsie and up and down the Hudson Valley. And it's absolutely free. It's, you know, it's got multiple Facebook accounts. It's got the YouTube access and radio, which we record for YouTube. But nobody takes advantage of it. The school, the small businesses here, we're located on Main Street here in Poughkeepsie. In fact, the march is going to go right by our front door. But nobody takes advantage of it. And it doesn't get no cheaper than volunteers. And I know that Mayor Rob Rollison wants to have an art commission and stuff and bring art back to the city with volunteers' help and stuff like that, which is good. And I know Mr. Robert Klein that sits on the council was the only one against it, you know, because, you know, which I can't understand, because you can't get no cheaper than an all-volunteer staff. But we're here, and we are the voice of the city of Poughkeepsie. I say that on every show, and nobody's taking advantage of it. You know, I believe in volunteer organizations. I run four of them in the past, and they all had incentives. One volunteer organization would be fixing bicycles, and they would give bicycles to the kids that helped me when I was chairman of the Partners in the Park, cleaning up the parks for 3 months out of the summer. And one just fed the other, didn't cost the city a dime. So, but the thing is, it just kept rolling, you know, one furnishing the other, but support from the city was not there. And now we have the multimedia thing going on, run by volunteers. They're not getting paid, like me and my co-host here. And they're not doing that. Now, we give incentives to college students who are studying broadcasting and journalism. And they're graduating with credits, you know. And I designed it to be like that, the same way Marist College students help in after-school programs. You know, and as far as students go, I think the Board of Education should supply incentives the same way the city should supply some sort of incentives for them to work together to slow the budget down, and they'd be able to afford, you know, rallies and marches and stuff like this, just like they did with Donald Trump, which I recorded the whole thing, you know, and it's on the YouTube account happening around the Hudson Valley. I recorded the whole protest against that, you know, when they walked behind the Civic Center all the way around, and even in the park next to Tubman, which is where I live. That's why I'm saying, you know, when there's, you know, incidences around town, I can hear it in Tubman, I hear it across the street, I have to tell the neighbors, take the kids inside and stuff like this, because I've been volunteering for 23 years now. And for 17 of those years, John Flowers, the late John Flowers, was my mentor. And he taught me how to do things right. And the only thing I have is my disability check and the outlet. Nobody else has a radio station attached to their multimedia account. See what I'm saying? It's easy to have a YouTube account. It's easy to have a Facebook account and put any ad you want to on it. But to have a radio station in order to get the word out, and nobody's still taking advantage of it, you know, because right now I'm selling time to try to keep the radio station going, and that comes with the sponsorship. You can sponsor the show with, you know, and for $100, that's 16 spots a month for a sponsorship. I don't have any sponsors, so we don't get paid. We wouldn't get paid if they did. They would just get their business name out there, and it would be on YouTube because we're recording the show. Or they can come on the show, or they can, you know, advertise on the Facebook and get commentary. They can even come on the show themselves because it's an unlocked door policy here. But nobody's taking us up on it. So it's a sad situation. So I know exactly how you feel when people let you down and you work hard for something that's right to try to help people. But I also know what it's like when people do a no-show. They say they will and then they don't. And it's a real heartbreaking experience. But this, to me, I feel like I got, you know, with your event that you put, and I know you don't live right here. You live 120, 130 miles away. And you have made this, you have tagged this as, you know, the City of Poughkeepsie's event, but you have put this together. And I give you major respect for that. I'm looking forward to it because for the simple fact, I've been a victim of it. And I have something to say every week about it, but I do it right here. And,
well, you know, the community did not understand because of this week, this event, and so a lot of negative hits, and that's understandable. You know, people are tired of marching. People are tired of the same old of gathering, but then to do nothing action later. If that is not our intention, I believe on Thursday I put on Facebook that this is not a hoo-ha event. This is not just a march. The march is the exercise of our life, the right to assemble, the right to freedom of speech, and the right to call our community together as a whole. But the community does not understand the time that it takes to align yourself with people that have a story, such as the Stanley Mosses, such as many of my performers. You know, I have a young lady who I've known for 30 years say, what is a bunch of singing going to do to violence? And we know that music brings people of all ethnic and social and economic backgrounds together. And we're doing that for one call. But my performer, and many of my performers, have been a victim of senseless acts of violence, or has lost a family member senseless acts of violence.
Yes,
some of my keynote speakers have been victims of senseless acts of violence, or had family members, you know, die to senseless acts of violence. You know, I have a gentleman, Kevin Connors, from the Colors Foundation. I talked to him briefly last night, and he's doing this special project, and he says, I feel like I'm a mortician. And it moved me. And he says, and he's doing a special project with every victim that has been lost to senseless acts of violence in the City of Poughkeepsie for over 20 years. He is making wooden crosses with their names attached to it. And he works tireless on this project, and he says, I don't even know what's the benefit of this. And I said, it's a way of raising awareness. This event will be up close and personal. It will touch many, many lives. All the way across the board, and we have people coming as far as Las Vegas, to this event, Florida, North Carolina, Virginia, and of course, me way upstate in New York, to attend this event, and I will tell you this, that we will not miss the mark here, and it's simple. It is to bring these people together of all walks of life, of all ethical backgrounds. We do have even the gay and lesbian communities will be in full effect. They will be there.
Yes,
because you know that they, such as Orlando shooting, has been targeted of senseless acts of violence.
Right. Just like Orlando.
That thinks that this is a hoo-ha event, this is a movement.
Yes, it is.
And Poughkeepsie hasn't seen a movement in a long, long time, if not ever.
Right. Well, they're going to now. But I hate to cut you short, sir, but my co-host here, Mr. Brian Conley, has a concert at the Balloon Festival in New Paltz, and we're going to go down there and highlight some of the local talent down there and try to get down there to having the hot air balloon festival up in New Paltz. And So I'm going to get down there and record that, but we are sort of squeezing our time out, so we're going to have to get off the air here. Actually, Joel Tyner called in and canceled because of the blood drive he's having in Rhinebeck today. But they changed the time on him. So we actually run in 55 minutes over. But I hate to cut the call short, but we're fixing to have to cut out of here due to our schedule. But I'm very thankful you called in, sir, and I have mad respect for you, and I can't wait to meet you face to face. There's just so much that I really feel that I want to coordinate with you, and this is going to go off like clockwork, and I know it's going to open a lot of eyes and ears, and people need to know, and they need to know that this movement's going to be an annual event. It's not going nowhere. It's going to keep getting bigger, and we're going to make sure it does. I'm just very thankful from as far away as you are, you was able to pull this together, and that comes straight from the heart. But for now, I do have to sign off. This is Happenings Around the Hudson, and you're listening to WHVW, the voice of the city of Poughkeepsie. And we're going to have to call it a day today, so I'm going to turn it over to Brian Conley, and I'm going to be packing up the cameras and everything. So you have a blessed day and a better tomorrow. Thank you very much for calling in, sir. All right, sir. Bye-bye.
All right, thank you for listening and joining us today. I think we still have another call. I'm not sure, though. I just tried that. We got a busy signal. Let's try it again. Hello? Okay, great. We only have a couple minutes. I'm sorry. We'll also be here next week. If you'd rather call in then, but you can talk to us now. Okay. Be right with you. Yeah, friends, we have one more call. We're going to handle this real quickly. This is Carol. She has some news she'd like to share with us. Thank you, Carol, for calling in. What's going on?
And let me just turn my radio down. Sadly, there have been at least three shootings so far this summer in Poughkeepsie. I am a subscriber to the Poughkeepsie Journal and have been since 1976 when I moved to Poughkeepsie, and I read the paper faithfully, mainly to find out the news in the community and keep up with what's going on. Excuse me. But June 23rd, Poughkeepsie Journal, they were talking about two shootings that had occurred, and saying that the city of Poughkeepsie police said they had believed there was a connection between the two shootings that occurred, and they claimed it was gang violence, but apparently they found a 21-year-old man at Maple Street and North Cherry that had been, as a result of a shooting there, been shot twice in both legs. And then it said in this article that was the second time, that was the second time that particular city resident had been the victim of a shooting. And then 2 days later, on Tuesday, it said that there had been shots fired in the area of Hume Park, and then right after that, they received reports of a man shot on Knoxon Street. So then at Knoxon Street, they found a 23-year-old resident with a gunshot wound to his lower right leg, and that particular victim also, was transported to the hospital for surgery, et cetera. And it said, during the investigations of each shooting, both victims said they did not know who shot them. and the investigations thus far indicate that both victims were the intended target of the shooter. So when I did say that particular article, there had been a previous article regarding a shooting that occurred, again, non-fatal, but it had been reported in the Poughkeepsie Journal, and I believe it was probably in the month of June. So if anyone has that information, but I think that attention should be brought to